Welcome back. Well, Tanzania is in national mourning for the next 2 weeks following the death of President John Magafuli. He was 61 years old. The vice president says Magafuli died Wednesday of heart problems in a hospital in Dar es Salaam. The announcement following speculation that he had been critically ill with COVID-19 during the course of the pandemic. Well, the late president had downplayed its dangers, previously claiming that Tanzania had defeated the virus through prayer. Well, CNN's David McKenzie is standing by for us in Johannesburg and joins us now. David, just take us through what we know about his death, because officially we're hearing it was heart complications, but there are a lot of particularly opposition politicians pointing to COVID-19.
Well, several weeks ago, Linda, my sources and other reporters' sources in Tanzania started raising the prospect that the president of Tanzania was sick with COVID-19. He did disappear for more than 2.5 weeks. He would regularly go to church services, often railing against the measures other countries had put in to try and stem the pandemic, including telling people not to wear masks, saying that vaccines shouldn't be coming into the country. He even at one point suspended the test for COVID-19 in the country, leading to a lot of pressure from the WHO and foreign diplomats in the country and even his neighbor, Kenya. So there were those rumors, many of them, not just from the opposition, but from everyone. But because of the secrecy around his health and his location, those for now haven't been exactly corroborated. As recently as last Friday, the prime minister warned people not to spread rumors. Several people were, in fact, arrested for doing just that. But given the secrecy and the autocratic nature of his presidency in many ways, I think many people are raising serious question marks. But the reality is, no matter what, this very prominent leader in East Africa has now officially passed away, and the vice president will take over.
And in terms of his legacy, David, the president was praised for cleaning up corruption. Did he reach that goal?
Well, certainly in the early years, he was known as the bulldozer. He came in, did get rid of government wastage. The previous administration to him was heavily tainted in allegations of corruption. So he was seen as someone who could get things done. I think since then, his legacy has become more complicated. He cracked down on the free press in Tanzania, civil society. He certainly rolled back, according to many, rights for young women and girls in the country. So it's a complicated legacy. Around the continent and overseas today, there have been praise and dismay at him passing, since it is a critical country in the continent and an important leader, of course. This is a significant moment. But I think behind the scenes from that, it is a complicated legacy, and that loss of democratic space in Tanzania, and of course, the way that he treated COVID-19, there were literally families trying to bury their loved ones in the cover of darkness last year, and so much confusion this year in the midst of what appeared to be a second wave of the disease, that in the short term at least will be his legacy for many going forward.
Absolutely. David McKenzie, good to have you on the story for us. Thank you very much. Well, I want to bring in a guest for more on this. Linus Kaikai is the Director of Strategy and Innovation at Citizen TV in Nairobi and joins us now via Skype. Good to have you with us. I have to ask you, obviously, about the president being one of the most prominent coronavirus skeptics in Africa. He was only 61 years old. How will he be remembered?
Thank you, Linda. The developments south of Kenya, the neighboring nation of Tanzania, have been received with a lot of shock, although there have been quite a lot of time to basically worry about what was going on there because of the stance taken by the president of Tanzania, John Pombe Magufuli, which is to stand in the opposite direction of everything COVID-19, whether it's vaccines, whether it's the way the disease is spread, or whether it's about masks. He always took a very, very different stance from the rest of the region. Now, the shock is this is the second president to die in this region of COVID-19. Last year, the president of Burundi, Pierre Nkurunziza, died over COVID-related complications. So in the region, it is quite a shock. And how he'll be remembered, quite a mixed legacy, because on one hand, he is well-regarded at home because of his developmental record, whether it's the infrastructure part, where he has managed to deliver on the standard gauge railway construction. A lot of bridges have been constructed, roads during his time. He's regarded quite well on that front. But diplomatically, he was quite a difficult term to deal with, even at the regional level. He doesn't attend meetings with fellow heads of states. He didn't seem to have very warm relations with his fellow presidents around the region.
So according to the vice president, he died of heart complications. It was opposition politicians that came out and said that he had COVID-19 because he hasn't been seen in public in recent weeks. Is there any other indication that he may have had the coronavirus?
I think the biggest indication that a lot of analysts are looking at is the number of people around the president that actually died of COVID-19. There was the first vice president of Zanzibar, Sheikh Sharif Hamad. There was also his chief of staff, who works literally next door in his office, also dying of coronavirus. And then there was the meeting that was held in Chato sometime mid-February that brought together all these leaders, three of them that are now dead. So it is expected that it is reasonable for somebody to draw a conclusion that if the people around you are falling dead because of COVID-19, it is very, very likely that even though the president had a health condition that started in 2006, he's been nursing one and walking with a pacer, actually. It is possible then that COVID-19 complicated that further.
Can you give us some sort of insight into how bad the COVID-19 situation is there, given that Tanzania hasn't reported any data since last April?
We can only speculate. There have been no official numbers out of Tanzania since April 2020. That is the position of President Magufuli. He just basically ordered an end to reporting of the numbers. So we have absolutely no indication. But just by looking at events around the border points, especially the border with Kenya, there was at one point 50 truck drivers tested positive. Literally every truck driver that was at the border post was testing positive for COVID-19. So even though the official numbers have not been coming out, it is believed that the situation there is not good at all.
His death, of course, creates quite a political vacuum there. How could his death alter the political landscape going forward?
The first thing that will happen is a major realignment of the ruling party structures within Tanzania. The constitution says that the vice president in the event like this, where the president dies in office, assumes office for the rest of the term. So what we expect to see in the next few days is the swearing in of Vice President Suluhu Hassan to be the next president and to serve until 2025. The picture will be clearer on Saturday, when the ruling party, it's called Chama cha Mapinduzi, or the Revolutionary Party, meets on Saturday to decide another very important appointment, and that is the appointment of who will be the next president. Just one thing that I would mention about the political method in Tanzania, it is a very thin line between the state and the party. So the ruling party has been in office since independence in 1960 to date. And what we'll expect also to see is a structure that balances power between the mainland Tanzania and the island Zanzibar. Suluhu Hassan, the vice president, comes from Zanzibar. So when she becomes president, the vice president automatically must be from the mainland. The other balance they have to strike is that of religion. When a president is Muslim, then the deputy president or vice president has to be a Christian. It is unwritten, it's not in anywhere in the constitution of Tanzania, but this was the method that was put in place by founding president Julius Nyerere. And it has been followed, and we expect it to be followed when Suluhu Hassan takes office anytime now.
All right, we'll have to leave it there. Linus Kaikai, Director of Strategy and Innovation at Citizen, TV Citizen, Nairobi. Good to have you with us. Thank you.